a daughter and two sons. Today is October the 28th, 1985. And because we've had a daughter-in-law who's done a superb job of putting all the family movies together, we have the privilege of being in a movie ourselves, and we're really excited about this. And so I guess we'll start out giving a little bit of our own personal history, and then we'll tell you a little bit about how we met, and we'll just see what happens from then on, because we want it to be something that will be interesting and enjoyable for you. My name is Frances Adelaide Metcalf. And when I married Philip Curran, well, I added Curran to my name. And so I think of myself as Francis Curran more than anything else now. But Metcalf was my family name, and I was born October the 4th, 1916, in the state of Indiana. My mother and father, my mother's name, Adelaide Vaughn Harrison. My father's name was James Albert Metcalf. And they were wonderful parents, and I was the oldest of four children. I think we'll let Grandpa tell his history now.
Oh, well, I was born right here in Washington, D.C. on December 27th, which was 2 days after Christmas. So that makes it kind of rough when you come so close to Christmas as far as birthday presents are concerned. But I was born on the corner, in a house on the corner of 8th and Taylor Street in Washington, D.C. Later on in my life, I guess I was about 5 years old, I moved with my mother and father and my brother to Pennsylvania. That was quite a memory for me. Things were so strange to leave a place such as this and the fun that we had and to go to a new area. Now, I haven't told you, my father's name was George. George Donnelly Curran. My mother's name was Grace Baker Curran. My mother was one of 11 girls and one boy, my Uncle Willie.
Forget your name.
I guess my mother was born about in the middle of this group of girls and Uncle Willie, and she was the very last to leave this earth. When I was born, they named me Philip. Philip Douglas. Why, I'll never know. But that's the name I came up with, and I've been happy with that name all my life. Now, when we moved into Pennsylvania, we settled down and just were a good, loving family. We did many things in central Pennsylvania, in Williamsport, Pennsylvania, Montoursville, Pennsylvania, one of the most beautiful spots in the world. And as I grew, I had many friends, did many things, many adventurous things, many things that I wouldn't want people to know about, as a matter of fact, because they were things that today we frown upon. Such as, we weren't really vandals, but we did things that were
mischievous.
But, you know, in those days when I was 12 years old, I had a rifle, I had a shotgun, I could go and do almost as I pleased. I had a dog that went with me everywhere. We'd go hunting and fishing and camping often. And then, when it came time for high school, I was kind of a smart aleck, and I didn't get along too well in school. So my father decided that the best thing, you know, I could shoot pool and I could make more money shooting pool than my father could give. Now that's not the thing for me to tell my grandchildren, but that was the case, to where he thought that he should get me away from this atmosphere. atmosphere. So he picked out a military school near Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, in the foothills of the Blue Ridge Mountains. A beautiful spot, but I didn't want to go. I just absolutely didn't want to go. But my father was a fair man and made a deal with me, you might say. Phil, if you'll go to that school and stay there until Christmas time, and if you don't like it, you can stay home. Well, that was fair enough, so I agreed to do that. And I'll never forget the day that they left me on the campus of that school with 200 or 300 wild boys that I didn't know and didn't like. Right off the bat, I didn't like. When I saw my mother and father drive out of that driveway, my heart was broken. I felt like I had been forsaken. And that night I could lie in my bunk, and it was a full moon, or nearly full, and I knew it was shining right down on my own house, my own home, my bed at home. And I was just very sick. In the next couple of days, I didn't have much to do with anybody, but I did meet a young fella that looked just about as sad as I felt. So I started to talk to him, and he didn't like it any better either. So we went to the headmaster and asked if we could room together, and he was obliging, and we did, and we became very good friends. But at Christmas time, when I came home, I said goodbye to everybody. But you know, before the Christmas vacation was over, I couldn't wait to get back to that school. So I spent 4 years there, and they were good years in my life. They did a lot for me, I do believe. I dread to think of what today would be like if it hadn't been for that school. But, you know, when I had to march around and carry that heavy rifle on my shoulder all day, I thought, this isn't too good. But I noticed the boys in the drum and bugle corps just had a little bugle in their hand, and that seemed like a better thing to do. So I practiced blowing a bugle until I could blow all the bugle calls. The next year, I was in the drum and bugle corps. We went on trips to Harrisburg and the different towns. We were in parades where the others couldn't do that. So
that was
finally,
the beginning of a great career.
The beginning of a great career. And I'm going to drop off right here and let Fran tell some of her youth. Fran?
Well, I was born in Indiana, as I said, but my parents moved several times. My earliest recollection was living in Atlanta, Georgia, and I know that's where my two sisters and my brother were born. From there we went down into the southern part of Georgia and then to Florida. My father was always trying to get in a situation where he could have his own newspaper, and he was a newspaper editor. And in Florida we did have our own newspaper. We lived in Winter Haven, and we were there several years, enough time to learn to swim well because there was lots of opportunities. Go fishing, there's lots of opportunities for that. Go through a few hurricanes, we had several of those, and you know, get a real feeling of being a Floridian, and we loved it there. But my mother and father didn't have very good health in Florida. My father had asthma very bad. And my mother contracted tuberculosis while we were there and was very ill, and they advised us to leave. And so my father started looking for opportunities out in Arizona, thinking that that would be a good climate for mother. And it turned out to be a very good climate. We did go out to Arizona, and mother did spend time out in the summer sun and out on the desert, just basking in the sun and with a lot of faith that she was going to be able to arrest this problem that she had. And she did. She accomplished that, and she did it without much medical help, too. We were in the throes of moving, and it was the beginning of the Great Depression, and my father was constantly moving on, trying to get a better situation. From southern Arizona, we moved up to northern Arizona and then over to California. And I started high school in California, in San Bernardino. it was really junior high school there. And my father was with the newspaper there, and we all enjoyed moving from one part of the country to the other. We weren't like gypsies. We moved very carefully, but we did drive across the country. We had an Auburn car, and we drove. And I can remember some very hair-raising experiences when we had flat tires, when we came close to the edge of a canyon where there was a big dam down below. And I was the oldest of the four children, so I was very much aware of what was going on, much more so than the others, I believe. One time, my dad was changing a tire, and the jack broke down and came down and hit him on the head, the fender of the car. I thought my mother was going to just die because she was sure he was going to die, but he came to very quickly and went on and finished changing the tire, and we kept going. It was just a small moment in our adventure, but it was a scary one. We lived in Stockton, California, last, having moved from Los Angeles area up from San Bernardino to Stockton. And Dad was associated with the newspaper there. And I went to high school there. And after high school, my mother and father decided that I needed to have something that would help me be able to make a living. So I went to business school. And I learned a few skills there which have sustained me in many ways since then. I passed the civil service exam and got a call to come to Washington. My mother thought that was the greatest thing in the world. She was so thrilled because she had a very strong patriotic feeling.
I'm glad she sent you to let you come.
Well, I am too, because that's where I met Grandpa. And I think maybe I'll let Grandpa tell about how we met, because after I came to Washington, I moved into a boarding house. And guess who was living in that boarding house?
Grandpa.
Right.
But he wasn't Grandpa then, you know.
No.
She's right. That was in 1936. And I came to Washington from Pennsylvania in 1936, mainly for the need of a job. You remember I said I was born here. Well, we had a little clout here, but there was no work. This is during the most dreadful part of the Depression. There were lines, soup lines everywhere, so many people out of work. My father was a burgess, the mayor of the town, and if there was a job available, it wasn't for me. He made sure somebody with a wife and a child or some needy person had the job. So the only thing left for me to do was to come to Washington, and I came here in 1936, and after a little while, I moved into a boarding house, and who should be there but Frances? And I'll never forget those days, because she was just a beautiful girl. And we had, in our dining room in this boarding house, there were four or five tables where we sat, and usually sat at the same table. And I used to say, gosh, I had to myself, I wish I could meet that girl. But she'd finish dinner before anybody, and two steps at a time, and she was upstairs. Pretty soon, a knock on the door, and she was gone. And I didn't know how that was going to come about. But one evening, I was late for dinner. I was the only one in the dining room. There was no TV, no television at that time. But we had a good radio, and I heard a piece of music on the radio in the living room. And it was a song that I had just heard the day before, or that day. And I liked it so well. The name of that song was Lamplight. Skinny Ennis was singing that, and he was the singer for Hal Kemp. And so I just got up from the table and went into the living room so I could hear it better. And who should be sitting there all by herself but Frances? And so I asked if I could sit and listen to that song, and I liked it so well. And she said she liked it too, and invited me to sit down. And we talked and talked and talked, and it seemed that the next day it was easier to talk, and we talked more, and we did little things, and pretty soon we were out taking walks. And then with the group from the boarding house, we'd go to a little place where they had a piano, and Fran would play the piano for us all. And we just had a wonderful time. Now that was about in October. And along along came November, and Thanksgiving was coming. I lived in Pennsylvania, my family did, and I was going home for Thanksgiving. And it seemed that Fran had no place to go. So I invited her to go with us, with me. And she didn't think that was a very good idea. But I told her the folks would love to have her and to please come. Well, about the day before I was ready to go, I said, the invitation still holds. And she said she'd like to go. Well, I borrowed a car from somebody, and we went to Pennsylvania. Had a good time at Thanksgiving time. Excuse me, I have a problem when I talk about it. And so we came back to Washington, and we were a little closer. We'd go for walks in the snow. You didn't have to worry in those days about anything. And we were truly in love. And it was just three or four days, a week before Christmas. And in this boarding house, Francis had two young ladies as roommates, and they were on the second floor. And I had a couple of roommates, and I lived on the third floor. Well, one evening there, I said, Fran, you know, if I had $2, I think I'd marry you. I'd like to marry you. She said, well, maybe I can get the $2. You ought to be back with that camera tonight. And so she said, maybe I can get the $2. So we went upstairs. I just was floating, and I didn't believe it, you know. And then all of a sudden, I heard her call me, and I went out in the hall. And she said, Phil, she said, my roommates are going to be gone, and they want to be at our wedding, so I think we ought to get married sooner. And I realized it was true. So we decided to get married on the 23rd of December. Now, you remember, 23rd of December, 25th is Christmas, 27th is my birthday. So I'm jamming things up already, making it tough. Well, anyhow, I borrowed a car on the 23rd, and we headed for Alexandria, Virginia. And we ran out of gas on the way. And I had to get gas. By the time we got gas and got over to the license bureau, they were pulling down the window. But she sold us a license, and we said, well, where would you suggest we go to get married? She said, well, there's a Methodist church across the street, and he marries a lot of people. So we went over there, and I can't remember his name now, but we sat down in the living room, and he asked me where I, what my faith was, and I said I was Presbyterian. And I said, but I went to a Methodist school for a while in Williamsport, the Dickinson Seminary in Lycoming County. And then he turned to Francis and he said, what's your faith? She said, well, we always went to the Congregational Church. He said, I'm so glad you're both Methodist. You know, and that sort of stopped us. But he invited us to come and be married that evening. And he said that the choir was practicing for Christmas, and we'd be married in the church and to bring our friends. Please don't throw rice. So we got some of our friends together, and one gave Fran away, and one was a bridesmaid, and I had a best man, and we had a regular wedding. And somebody sang, I love you truly. I'll never forget that. So that is how we got married, and we are now in our 48th. Year of marriage, and we have a lot of wonderful children. Well, we have three wonderful children and 22 beautiful grandchildren. Now I'm going to let Fran talk a little bit and tell something about
it. Well, one of the things that happened when we got married, you know, you always want to have a special dress or something for a wedding, But this was a cold time of the year, and I couldn't see how in the world I could go get a fancy wedding dress. So I took a friend with me and went looking, and I ended up with, of all things, a black suit. Now, that doesn't sound very nice, but it had a big fur collar, and it looked really pretty nice, and I got a green satin blouse to go with it. And I think about it now, it doesn't sound like much of a wedding, but it was warm, and I felt very dressed up, and I had flowers. We had, and I had a beautiful ring. That was one of the really exciting things, was that Grandpa got me a beautiful ring and gave it to me there in the boarding house, an engagement ring. So I really felt like it was a wedding in every sense of the word, though it was, we didn't take a lot of time to plan it. After the wedding, we did something that was different from what most people do. We wanted to have something that would be symbolic or something that would mean something special to us. So we stopped on the bridge, the Lincoln Memorial Bridge, broke the ring box in half. Each of us threw a half over into the river with our friends standing by applauding us. And it didn't have any special significance. It was just something to do. I don't think we even named what significance it might have, but it was symbolic of our marriage and something we remembered and thought about afterwards for many years. That was the beginning of a really unusual marriage.
To say the least.
To say the least. We had several years when we didn't have any children, and when the first one came along, Doug, we were living out on Connecticut Avenue in Washington, D.C., and Doug arrived in a doctor's hospital.
Do you remember the number of that apartment?
3616.
That's right.
3616 Connecticut Avenue. And Doug was born January 14, 1942.
So that means we were married 5 years before Doug came along.
That's right.
But we were busy people.
Yeah, we just worked, and we thought we had to entertain friends and keep up with our jobs working.
Well, there was something very interesting about this. When we first married, and we kept right on going to work, and we were very underpaid. Maybe we weren't underpaid for the time, but I think I made $52.50 every 2 weeks, and Fran made a little bit more than that. But I had a talent that I was pretty good with a pen, with drafting and drawing or something. And in the office that I was in, which was a huge office, we handled the accounts for the emergency relief organizations, PWA, WPA, and so on. But the community chest had a drive each year for the poor, and in each office was a big thermometer. And as we contributed, it would go up. But that was the worst looking thing anybody ever saw, and the boss didn't like it. And he said, we gotta have something different. And they said, well, let Phil Curran draw one. He draws on the walls, on the file cabinets, and on the file jackets. He draws and he can probably do it. So he came back and asked me if I'd do it. And I said, sure, I'd like to do that. And he got me what I needed to do it, and I did. I made a beautiful thing, and he was happy. A few days later, he came to me with a bunch of figures, and he said he had to go to a meeting and explain these expenditures, all this money, and he felt he could do it better if he had a chart or a graph or somehow to show a picture, a visual presentation rather than just words. And I said, I'd be glad to try it. And so he got me a whole drafting set. T-squared, drawing board, everything. And I made it for him, and he liked it. And I did that more often. Then one day, in came somebody from the main Treasury Department and talked to me for a while and finally left. And all of a sudden, I discovered I'd gotten a raise to $2,000, which was unheard of. And I couldn't wait to get home to tell Francis. And as I got home and came into the house, and I said, what do you know? She says, let me tell you, I talked to Senator Downey today, and he asked me to work in his office for $2,000. That was the same day. Now, we were rich kids, I'll tell you that much right away. We got a nice Oldsmobile, had a charge account here and a charge account there. Everything that we shouldn't be doing, but we did.
One thing we ought to say right now before we get any farther is that when I met Grandpa, I had a camera.
Oh, yeah.
And because I had a camera, Grandpa became a cameraman. And if he hadn't become a cameraman, we wouldn't be here because we wouldn't have taken all these movies that Jan's gone to so much trouble to put together and put into a videotape for all of you to enjoy. And so as the years went by during our marriage, we managed to take as many movies as we could, starting out with our first boy, Doug. And so I think that, I hope the grandchildren will enjoy seeing their parents, at least one of their parents, in these movies, because they have lots of memories and they'll have bring out lots of memories for each one of them and give them something to think about and to reflect on through the years. It's been...
Well, I guess that camera was a very important thing.
It started it all.
Because Senator Downey asked Francis to go to Los Angeles, where his office was, and to manage that office. And so I was to go along, and he made it possible for me to work for the Federal Housing Administration. There, I did a lot of drafting, and which was beneficial. And when we came back to Washington, I had something that I could show that I could do other things. And so I joined the Office of Information, which became the Office of Strategic Services, which is now CIA. And there we did a lot of things. We did propaganda posters, we did everything. It was a very top secret organization. And they bought a motion picture unit from New York, the complete thing, and that was so exciting for me that I made it possible that I could join that group. Thereby, I became a motion picture cameraman and learned a lot about pictures and what to do, so that when I went into the service, I was picked as a cameraman to be on the atomic bomb project, the Manhattan Engineering District, which was very thrilling and exciting.
Grandpa's really famous, I'll tell you.
Oh, he's not famous.
Yes, he is.
No.
He had an interesting, wonderful thing.
Well, it's been interesting.
Great career.
And we're getting, son is bored, as usual.
It's probably spent all the time we should spend.
Well, let's do one and have some more children and grandchildren and bring them up to date with pictures.
Well, we hope that you're going to enjoy it. Remember, Aunt Jan's the one you can thank for all of this, because she's done the work and she's done a great job pulling all these family movies together.
I don't know. Someday it might be Mom Jan or Grandma Jan or somebody. If this keeps going, we're all going to have children and grandchildren. So it's been nice talking to you folks. I hope you've enjoyed it. I know that I'm getting hoarse from talking. So good night. And God bless you.
then they grew, and now mommies are women. Women with children, busy with children and things that they do. There are a lot of things a lot of mommies can do. Some mommies are ranchers, or poetry makers, or doctors and teachers, or cleaners or bakers. Some mommies drive taxis, or sing on TV. Yeah, mommies can be almost anything they wanna be.
Well, they can't be grandfathers, or daddies. Daddies are people. People with children. When daddies were little, they used to be boys like some of you. But then they grew, and now daddies are men. Men with children. Busy with children and things that they do. There are a lot of things a lot of daddies can do.
Strong.
throw a ball, my brother and I. Guess who's growing up so tall, my brother and I. Guess who likes to build things with saw and hammer and nails. Guess who goes exploring, discovering new trails. Guess who likes to race and climb, my brother and I. Guess who wrestles all the time, my brother and I. Guess you'll never know why I love him like I do, unless you're lucky and you have a brother. We'll be right back.
splash, I was taking a bath. Long about a Saturday night. Yeah. Rubbed up, just relaxing in the tub. Thinking everything was alright. When I stepped out the tub, I put my feet on the floor. I wrapped the towel around me and I opened the door. And in a splish splash, I jumped back in the bath. Shoes on. Yeah!
Yeah.
And I disco to say I love you, and I mean it from the bottom of my heart. You're not around.
Can I speak to Deborah Sue?
Hi, don't you go.
just a Spanish tamale, according to me. Right off the boat from the tropics, far, far away. Which is kind of funny, since where I come from is Allentown, PA. Spanish. Okay, may I'll be Spanish. Right after I've married Alberto, I'll be the toast of Chichi Castanango. And all day long my castanets will click. I'll hide behind my fan and do the tango. I'll be so Spanish it will make you sick. I'll eat the tacos and the enchilada. I'll drink tequila till I feel no pain. The only song I'll sing will be Granada. I'll be more Espanol than Abby Lane. So call me the wild Spanish rose, the craziest flower that grows. I'll kick up my heels and see how it feels to be sultry Spanish rose. Olé! Behind my mantilla.
sing a few songs for you this afternoon. A few have variety in them, and a few that I like, and I hope you like them too. I was in Brazil for 2.5 years of my life, and I don't know if you know it or not, but in Brazil, there's a samba, and it's built upon one note. And other notes are bound to follow, but the root is still one note. Now this new one is the consequence of the one we've just been through, as I'm bound to be the unavoidable consequence of you. Eis aqui este sambinha, between uma nota só. Outras notas vão entrar, mas a base é uma só. Esta outra é consequência do que acabo de dizer. Como eu sou a consequência inevitável de você. Quanta gente existe por aí que fala tanto e não diz nada, quase nada. Já me utilizei de toda a escala e no final não sobrou nada. Onde eu e nada e você pra minha nota. Como eu volto pra você, vou contar com a minha nota. Como eu gosto de você. E quem quer todas as notas, vem me fá sol, lá, si, dó. Fica sempre sem nenhuma, fica em uma nota só. There's so many people who can talk and talk and talk and just say nothing, or nearly nothing. I have used up all the scale I know, and in the end I've come to nothing, or nearly nothing. So I come back to my first note, as I must come back to you. I will pour into that one note all the love I feel for you. Anyone who wants the whole show, re mi fa sol la ti do, he will find himself with no show. Better play the notes you know.